very much, sir. Thank you very much. So let's begin. In this lecture and the next lecture, we are going to drive electrostatics from electrostatics by one simple Lorentz transformation of the electric force from one thing to another. It's actually going to be very simple. And before I do that, let me just quickly review electrostatic and electrostatics, their basics, just for the sake of completeness, which I'm sure that most of you already know. So electrostatics is based on Coulomb's law, which is essentially that if you have two point charges, let's say Q1 and Q, the force between the two in modern SI units is 1 over 4 pi epsilon r, Q1, Q, r minus r1 divided by r minus r1 magnitude, where r1 is the position vector of this charge and r is the position vector of that charge, and r minus r1 is this one. So you can also write it like q1 q over r minus r1 square, magnitude square, and then the unit vector. So I wrote the unit vector as vector over magnitude, so it becomes q. We can express it using the field concepts like this, that we imagine that this Q1 charge has an electric field around it, and the field is given by this expression Q1 Now, this is the field produced by Q1 at point R. And when you have to find the force on another charge Q, all you do is just multiply this field with that charge. So we can express this force in terms of the field concept. Essentially, the foundation of electrostatics, that we have a Coulomb law for computing the electric field, and then we have a Coulomb force law to compute the force on any other charge Q because of this charge Q. I chose a little bit different notation. Instead of R and R prime or R1 and R2, I chose R for the field point where we are going to have the test charge, and R1 is the position vector of the source charge, which is producing the field. Everybody is comfortable with this notation and we are fine. Now, this is a field of a point charge, or you can call it that this is the green function of this charge of electrostatic, because a green function is the solution of the field for a point source. So here the point source is point charge. So this is nothing but a green function in electrostatics, because this gives this field for a point source. So if we have more than one charges, and they are discrete, like one here, one here, one here, and we want to find the force on this charge, total force, all we need to do is sum the field due to individual charges and write the total field, and then we multiply with Q to find the force. But if we have, instead of a discrete charge distribution, if we have a continuous charge distribution, let's say in some volume V, there's a charge continuum with some chart distribution row of R, then the field at this point with position vector R, let me just label it R1, can be found simply by the superposition principle x 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught sum over volume of row 1 q dq r. But this way of my writing as dq r1 simply means that this is a volume integral. It's a triple integral. So you have to, in any coordinate system that you are, you perform the integration along the three coordinates and then you find the area. So this is for the volume charge density that we are going to do. If this is the surface charge distribution, you have a surface charge density here and then the integration is over surface, you triple, double integral. If this is a line charge, you have a linear charge density here and the integration is only along the line, only one. Are you familiar with delta functions?
Yes.
Okay, that's good. So you can go back from here to here if you want to find the chart into a point chart, you can appreciate that the chart density for a point chart is nothing but q1 delta of r minus r1. For a point chart, then you substitute this row here and this q1 gets out and the because this will be a little bit of confusion. Let me R1 here and sum R0. So you put this thing here and then you perform integration over R1. So the integral goes away and you evaluate the rest of the function at R1 is equal to R0. So R1 is replaced by R0 and you recover this thing with R1. So we know that electrostatic can equivalently be represented using differential equations. So this is the integral form of electrostatic. It's based on Coulomb law. But we can also have two differential equations to find electric field and then from electric field find it. And we can find those things simply by this. If we have electric field like this. This thing, R minus R1 over R minus R1 magnitude Q, can actually be written as like this. So I'm not going to prove this mathematical identity, but this vector over vector magnitude is actually equal to the minus of the gradient of whatever magnitude. You can prove it if you like. So if I can write it like this, equivalently I can take this minus then out. So minus 1 over. If we take an integration R1 cube, ye del jo hai ye R pe operate kar raha hai. So del or integral jo hai ye interchange kiya ja sakta hai. And if I define some function, let me call it, for the moment let's call it v, of r as minus as 1 over 4 pi epsilon r. Then this gives us that v can be written as minus 10. So this V is the electric scale of the function. And now, if I take del cross on both sides, so we know that the curl of gradient of any scalar function is identically zero. So this means that del cross 2 is zero. So this is one differential equation, and to get the so this I got from this fact. For any arbitrary phi, this thing moves. So that's why, since this has been written as del of some scalar, so it means its cross has to be zero. Another equation. Can be formed as by taking del dot on both sides, because to specify a vector completely you need to specify its curl and gradient because of Fermat's theorem. So that's why one equation has to be for the curl and the other equation should give what's the divergence of this if you want to completely specify the electric field. So I can find the divergence from there. So this is minus 1 over 4 epsilon naught square. Del dot del is del square. I have to use another identity from vectors. Actually, del square of 1 over r is nothing but 4 pi delta of r minus r1. So this del square 1 over r minus r1 can be replaced with delta t minus 4 pi. 4 pi goes with 4 pi, so minus also goes away, 1 over epsilon naught. Now when we have a delta function in 3 dimension and there is integration over 3 dimension, the integral goes away and this function has to be evaluated at the value of r1 where this argument is 0. So r1 is equal to r, so this gives us rho of r over. So this is the second. इस उदाहरण आप इस तरह ये सोच रहे होंगे कि ये एनर्जीज कहाँ से आ रही है, जैसे वहाँ पे हमने ये r vector और r cube उससे कर लिया. So even if we don't know the proofs or they use too much, don't worry too much about it. इसका मेरा आपको शो करने का जो मकसद है वो सिर्फ ये था, वो ये था कि ये जो equation है e की, this is equivalent to these two equations, two differential equations to specify electric field completely. And they both come from the Coulomb's law. And Coulomb's law comes from experiment. So this is the point. और हम देखेंगे कि हम जो electromagnetics develop करने जा रहे हैं, we only need one experimental fact and that is this Coulomb's law. We are going to derive everything else from this Coulomb's law. And just one other thing which we are going to use. We can obtain what is called Gauss law by integrating this equation on both sides over some closed volume. Let's say I have some volume V, and if we integrate this thing on both sides over this volume, so this integration of the charge, volume charge density of volume will give us the charge enclosed by this volume, and this thing I can convert to a surface integral. Over the surface S of this volume
this is the case.
कि मेरे जो गोल सर्कल का इसका मतलब ये है कि दिस सरफेस हैज टू बी क्लोज्ड, क्योंकि ये वॉल्यूम है तो जो सरफेस इसको क्लोज कर रही है दैट्स क्लोज्ड, दैट्स व्हाई वी हैव अ वॉल्यूम.
सही है. आपने ये डेल डॉट की जो डिवाइडर्स का ये ईजी उसके बाद गॉसियन को मोटिवेट किया कैसा?
सॉरी,
सर डिवाइडर्स के बाद गॉसियन को कैसे मोटिवेट किया था
यहां से?
जी प्लेन उससे ऊपर.
सो ये जो इक्वेशन है यहां से कैसे है?
मैं ये इससे यहां से.
सो ये मेरे पास डिफरेंशियल फॉर्म है. Now, to drive the Gauss law, let's consider some volume V. It has some charge density. But if I do the volume integral, so we get this thing. But this volume integral can be converted into that surface integral using Gauss divergence theorem. Because this quantity ki divergence hai, ab uska jo surface integral le, so we get that they're both the same thing. और राइट साइड पे चूंकि वॉल्यूम चार्ज एंड सी का डायरेक्ट इंटीग्रल आ जाएगा व्हिच इज द टोटल चार्ज. सो इसको आप यू भी लिख सकते हैं. सो दिस इज नथिंग बट टोटल फ्लक्स. सो टोटल फ्लक्स इज इक्वल टू द चार्ज ओवर एप्सिलॉन नॉट. बाय द वे जस्ट टू शो यू इसको आप यू इमेजिन कर सकते हैं. सो कहीं पे कोई इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड है व्हिच इज गोइंग थ्रू इट. फर्स्ट थिंग यहां पे कुछ चार्ज डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन है रो. सो कुछ भी इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन तो आपने करना ही है टोटल फ्लक्स के लिए कि एट ईच पॉइंट यू टेक द नॉर्मल कंपोनेंट ऑफ इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड टू द सरफेस एरिया और हर पैच पे कंप्यूट करते जाए एंड देन यू ऐड द ऑल अप सो यू गेट दिस टोटल फ्लक्स. सो दिस इज नथिंग बट ई डॉट डी स्क्वायर. डी स्क्वायर आर इज द एरिया. सम पीपल वुड लाइक टू राइट दिस इंटीग्रल लाइक दिस. सो केवल इट इज द सेम थिंग. So, operationally it means you find the component of electric field normal to the surface at each point and add all the contributions and this should be equal to the total charge enclosed inside this surface over epsilon naught. It's also better to qualify this thing that this is the enclosed charge, not the charge outside. If there is some charge here, it doesn't contribute to the total flux through this surface. We go to the field enter or the field exit. Okay. So let's now come to a quick review of mechanical statics. And we are not going to be worrying about the applications of these invariants in this course. Magneto statics. Historically and traditionally, magnetostatics comes from the experiments of Ampere, Biot, and so on. And it says that if you have some currents flowing in a volume with some current density J, then you can find the magnetic field at some point with position vector r using a certain formula. But before I do that, let me just review what we mean by the volume current density and the other current densities. You see, if we have a thin wire with zero cross sectional area, okay, ideally speaking, an extremely thin wire with no cross, with an infinitesimally small cross sectional area, and there is some current I flowing through it, we can think of it as linear current with current, which is dq by dt, the amount of charge flowing per unit time. If we have some surface, let's say there is a surface like this, and some current is flowing on this surface. And let me also make this surface to have variable area. So for these situations, we can define a surface current density. And let's say if it is uniform, then I can compute the total current I. Total current I is the total charge that is flowing per unit time. And then the surface current density is I over this cross-sectional area W with this direction, whatever this direction is. So surface current has the units of ampere per meter, not ampere per surface direction. Because it's called surface current because it's flowing on the surface, but it's ampere per unit length. But the length is the cross sectional length. अब देख सकते हैं कि अगर same current यही इधर भी आ रही है, तो यहाँ पे क्योंकि ये cross sectional length increase हो गई है, तो यहाँ पे density कम हो जाएगी. जो भी यहाँ पे W है, and if it is varying at each point, then you take small differential length at each points, and then you divide the current flowing at this region by this cross sectional length, and then you have this surface current. Volume current, on the other hand, is something that flows in a volume. Let's say this is some pipe. And some current is flowing inside it. Then in this situation we can define a volume current density. Which is total current divided by, अगर इसमें यूनिफॉर्म है तो यू कैन टेक लेट्स से दिस क्रॉस सेक्शन एरिया इज ए, सो देन आई गो ए एंड दिस हैज सम डायरेक्शन आई डोंट नो जे हैट. सो वॉल्यूम करंट हैज यूनिट्स ऑफ एम्पीयर ओवर मीटर स्क्वायर, बट इट्स डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड इन द वॉल्यूम, इट्स फंक्शन ऑफ ऑल थ्री स्पेशियल कोऑर्डिनेट्स. हियर इट्स फंक्शन ऑफ टू स्पेशियल कोऑर्डिनेट्स. So it can be integrated over surface, because this is surface current, even though it's under the nature of this thing. Okay, so with this thing, let's come back to the electrostatic and the basic experimental law is by Ortho-Mort law, which says that you can compute the magnetic field as mu naught 4 pi. Basically, you have a given volume current as a function of R1, and then the field at some point P with position vector R, you can compute the field at this point using this expression. And once we have the field, the force at any charge Q at this location moving with velocity V is given by the Lorentz force law. Q V plus V. So these two equations describe the electrostatics coming in. Or this way, you can find its various form. If it's a surface current density, then surface current density comes here, and this is a double integral only d square r. If it is a linear current density, then I comes here and the direction is the direction of the current flow. People for linear current, people actually like to write IDM. This DDR1 actually goes here because the direction of current is the same as the direction of that element. So then the integral is here. But this is the general form which is valid in our three dimensions. Now we can derive the differential equations for the numerical statics from this Bayes-Savart law, and we can also derive the Ampere's law from here. Let me quickly do that. You don't have to worry too much about particle calculus, because I'm not going to require from you to do other things from other than what I'm doing here. So again, this quantity can be written as minus del of 1 over r minus r1 . So with this simple thing I can actually take this del cross out, this minus you can also write here, and this becomes actually, I think the minus would be needed. This becomes j of r1 r minus r1 ESLP operation is not simple, yet we just take this del cross out because now it's more complicated. You have to use this formula for this thing, which is the del cross some phi A. This is equal to del phi cross A plus phi del cross A. अगर आप यहाँ पे देखें, इसको phi समझते हैं, ठीक है? So this J is here. So A cross del phi, क्योंकि minus sign है, तो सब में formula में है del phi cross A. So उसको उठा के दूँगा minus sign, वो खत्म हो गया, वोटर मार. दूसरी ये वाली term इसपे zero है, क्योंकि जब del cross पे लूँगा तो ये देखिए r1 का function है, del जो है वो सिर्फ r पे operate होगा. So del cross A जो है वो इसमें zero होगा, इसलिए I can write this thing just equal to del cross of scalar into vector. This 1 over r minus r1 is scalar and this j is vector. So but क्योंकि del जो है वो r पे operate हो रहा है, integral r1 पे है, I can take del cross. ठीक है? Okay, so once we have this, first thing you can easily recognize that we can write B as del cross A, where this A is magnetic vector potential defined as mu naught 4 pi j of r1 r minus r1 b2 r. So this is a vector potential, but more importantly, if I take the divergence on both sides, because to get a differential equation, we have to specify the divergence in terms of B. So if I take divergence on both sides, I immediately get that del dot B has to be equal to 0, because the divergence of the curl of any vector is 0. So the second thing that taking del cross B, actually I'm not going to want it now, but using vector identities I can easily show that this is mu naught J, but since that's not our main part, I'm just going to use this. If you take del cross, this is del cross this thing, and you open del cross and use vector identities, you can see that this comes out. So what I will have is that I will, since Bilal is going to type this lecture, so I will give my notes to him, he will include those few steps as well. So important thing is this, that if I can establish this and this, the numerical statics is established. So in the remainder of this lecture and the next, that's what I'm going to do. That we are going to begin from the Coulomb law, and we are going to arrive at Biot-Savart law, and we are going to drive this Lorentz force equation by transforming the Coulomb force. So once I have done that, that essentially means that I have established electrostatics, and we don't need this additional experimental. If we can assume that the special relativity is correct. So actually, it's amazing. Only I think 2 or 3 years after special relativity, people realized that you can drive this electrostatics and electrodynamics from Coulomb's law by just transformations. So we'll try to follow in their footsteps, and let's begin our discussion. So you have to see how this all unity. Alright. And you will see actually it's very simple. But it's amazing as well. So let me assume two reference points. And in this process, I'm not only going to establish nuclear statics from there, we are going to get brand new results as well for one situation that is not covered by either electrostatics or nuclear statics. And that is, if I have a charge here and another charge here, and they are both stationary in my frame, we know that we can use the Coulomb law. Right? But let's say this charge is stationary, but this is moving. So it's a bit more than the derivation of the nucleostatic. So let me begin with this situation. Let's say we have this observer. And again, our rotations are the same, that this one is moving with speed u relative to this thing. Or you can imagine if this is stationary and this is moving with speed minus u in this direction. So let me take a charge q1 prime, which is stationary in this frame, and another charge q which is moving with velocity v in this frame, with velocity so v prime in this. Let me also put it up prime. So in this frame the quantities are prime, so q1 prime is at rest, q prime is moving with speed v prime at some instant. Now, let me imagine that this produces some electric field E naught prime. I'm putting E naught prime, E naught because this is at rest in this one, and prime because it is the prime coordinate. And since, and if we assume special theory of relativity to be correct, we have to assume two things, not only the Lorentz transformation, but also the first law. Don't forget the first law. First postulate. From the second postulate, from the constancy of speed of light, you can drive Lorentz transformation. But we can transform other quantities and forces and fields by also assuming the accuracy of the first principle, which is the principle of relativity. Right? So in this frame, if this charge is at rest, then let's assume that Coulomb's law hold as it is. So there will be some field in our prime, which we can write 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught q1 prime. And let's say the position vector of this charge is r prime, and the position vector of this charge is some r1 prime. So then q1 prime, we have r minus r1 prime q, r prime minus r1 prime. So this is the field, electrostatic field produced in this frame. So in that frame, the form of that force would be F prime Q prime E naught.
Sir, isn't charge Q prime moving?
Yes, Q prime is moving.
As we are just taking a random number.
But you see, how we get this, since this is at rest, this definitely has this field. And that charge will experience a force like this.
And won't that force be changing at every instant?
Yeah, this is function of time as well. I'm suppressing that. Now, let's see what's the picture going to look like from this frame, where we are situated, we want to make observations. So in this frame, let's say this charge Q1 prime is some Q1, and then that charge Q prime is some Q, and let's say this is moving with some speed V, usme V prime hai, usme kuch V ho. Aur ab lekin ye bhi address ki ho, ye bhi move kar raha. It will actually be moving with speed, let's say V1, it is nothing but X hat Q right? This case. And so is frame ke andar, let's say the there will be some let me come back to this one later. Let's just first concentrate on this thing. This way, the quantity is written here, this way, the quantity is written here. R prime minus R1 prime vector, it's nothing but R prime, R1 prime is X prime minus X1 prime, X hat, Y prime minus Y1 prime, Y hat, Z prime minus Z1 prime, Z hat. और इसकी जो magnitude है, is x prime minus x1 prime square okay in that way. So इसको मतलब है कूलम्ब फोर्स क्या होगी? अब ये वेक्टर और ये चीजें यहाँ पे हमें पुट कर दें, यू गेट दीज एक्सप्रेशंस. नाउ लेट्स कम टू दिस थिंग इन दिस कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम. अच्छा, इसमें मैं जस्ट एक कमेंट करना चाहूंगा कि मैं ये सारा डिस्कशन करूंगा इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड के साथ. बुक में ऑलमोस्ट in parallel discussion there, but he is using the displacement factor with is perhaps in some ways little bit better, okay. Displacement factor D is nothing but the flux density, or we are looking at one of the assumption we have related, but I will basically talk about it. I think this is little bit easier to follow. So in the O system, we have this charge Q1 and this charge Q, and let me right now imagine that this has some field E, this Q1. Like I give you a form, but I don't know what that form is, because this Q1 is moving. And then there is charge Q, so the force on that charge Q would be like this if we assume the form of the force to be the same. So this is the force on that charge as seen in this way. So to find this force, we have to now transform this force into this coordinate system. Okay? So this is our major tool, that we are going to transform
the components of the force between the two into the components of the force in this coordinate system. Aur uske liye we already have the derivations for the components. So let me just recall that. ये फॉर्मूला हमने ड्राइव किए थे तीन एफ एक्स प्राइम So this is how the force transforms under Lorentz transformation from this coordinate to this one. But I want to write it in such a way that this force transforms to that one. So we can find, I want to find fx, fy, and fz. So uske liye we can do very simple thing. Yeah, fx mein rakhta hu, is term ko bhi to le jata hu, isko bhi to le jata hu, plus fy aur fz ki value le jata hu, yahan se put kar. तो फिर ये एफ एक्स की वैल्यू आ जाएगी इन टर्म्स ऑफ एफ एक्स प्राइम एफ वाई प्राइम एफ सी प्राइम और एफ वाई की वैल्यू एफ वाई प्राइम से सीधी सीधी यहीं से आ जाएगी उधर जाकर उधर जाकर उधर जाकर उधर जाकर
इसके रेस्ट में तो डी एक्स डी वाई और डी 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 हो गया क्या इसके बाद रेस्ट में
रेस्ट में क्यों है
नहीं होते फ्रेंड ओ प्राइम में
ओ प्राइम में ओ प्राइम में सी प्राइम वी प्राइम में
रेस्ट में लगा
ठीक है और इसमें इस मूविंग विद वेलोसिटी वी
दोनों पे रहते हैं
सो वी आर पिक्चरिंग दिस थिंग एज अ फोर्स ऑन दिस थिंग बिकॉज ऑफ सम फील्ड व्हिच हैज बीन क्रिएटेड बाय लेट्स से दिस सॉल्व एंड दैट सो लेट्स फाइंड द एफएक्स फ्रॉम देयर सो एफएक्स विल बी एफएक्स प्राइम पहली टर्म दूसरी टर्म इधर आएगी और एफ वाई की वैल्यू यहाँ से पुट करेंगे तो प्लस एक हो जाएगा यू वी बाय सी स्क्वायर कापा एफ वाई का ये जो वो वन माइनस यू वी एक्स ओवर सी स्क्वायर है वो कैंसिल हो जाएगा प्लस यू वी जी ओवर सी स्क्वायर कापा z prime and fy is simply kappa 1 minus u dx squared fy prime so ye aage force ke form और जो टोटल फोर्स एफ है वेक्टर फॉर्म में उसको यू लिखा जा सकता है एफ एक्स एक्स है एफ वाई वाई है गिव दीज टर्म्स सम नेम सो ये वाला पार्ट है जो वेलोसिटी पे डिपेंड है देखें ये वी एक्स वी वाई वी जी वगैरह इस पार्ट पे आ रही है इस टर्म में कहीं भी वेलोसिटी नहीं आ रही कापा आ रही But there's no particle velocity involved in this term. So let me just write this thing as FC and FP. अब FC तो ये आ गया सीधा सीधा. This is FC. और FM ये आ गया. लेकिन मैं इसको थोड़ा सा ज़्यादा rearrange कर देता हूँ. क्योंकि इसको थोड़ा गौर से देखें. तो इसमें एफ एक्स कहीं भी नहीं एफ एक्स प्राइम भी कहाँ पे एफ एक्स प्राइम अरे इस टर्म की बात एफ एक्स जो टर्म है इसकी बात है तो इसका मतलब है फोर्स के सिर्फ वो कंपोनेंट्स यहाँ पे नजर आ रहे हैं जो वी वन वेलोसिटी के परपेंडिकुलर क्योंकि v है v1 x के अलावा ना v1 इज इक्वल टू x है तो अगर उसका मैं x है वेक्टर x है f के साथ क्रॉस प्रोडक्ट ले तो सिर्फ fy और fc आएगा बाकी कंपोनेंट नहीं x कंपोनेंट नहीं है क्योंकि अगर आप x का x हैट का क्रॉस देते हैं वेक्टर के साथ तो x हैट क्रॉस x हैट जीरो हो जाएगा सिर्फ y और z कंपोनेंट तो इसका मतलब है कि इसको आप लिख सकते हैं इस फॉर्म में fm है कापा u c स्क्वायर और ये जो v आ रहा है वेक्टर ये v y जो है और vz आ रहे हैं अगर इनको देखें तो ये कैन एक्चुअली राइट इट एज v क्रॉस x हैट क्रॉस अभी चेक कर ले अगर आप करना चाहते हो ठीक है तो दिस x हैट क्रॉस f इसका अगर बीच और क्रॉस ले तो एग्जैक्टली ये चीज आ रही जस्ट लीव इट टू यू टू वर्क अब थोड़ा सा जरा इसको जनरल टर्म पे लिखने के लिए कोड कापा ही है एंड दिस सी अंडर दिस थिंग दिस v ओवर c क्रॉस और ये जो ux है दिस इज नथिंग बट v1 ओवर c क्रॉस तो दिस इज कॉमन
सही है तो v बार आपने लिया है क्या चीज है
v बार कौन सा ये v वेलोसिटी है q पार्टिकल
अच्छा
अच्छा ये जो यहां पे कंपोनेंट आ रहा है vy vz vx और vz जो आ रहे
हैं q
ओके सो इससे अब आपको थोड़ा दावा होना शुरू हो गया अगर मैं ये केस लूं लेट्स से केस इधर पहुंचे लेट्स मी टेक अ सिंपल केस फर्स्ट इन दिस केस लेट मी अज्यूम दैट v प्राइम इज minus u x अगर v prime ये हो तो v क्या होगी क्यों ना जी अगर prime coordinate में जो q particle है उसकी speed minus u है तो जो o system है उसके लिए v क्या होगी v क्या होगी minus 2u ये देखिए ये एक सिस्टम है लेट्स से बोर्ड जो है ना ये प्राइम वाला कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम ये मेरे लिहाज से इधर को जा रहा है विद स्पीड लेकिन इसके अंदर एक पार्टिकल है कि वो अपने सिस्टम के लिहाज से माइनस यू से इधर को जा रहा है तो एसेंशियली मेरे तो सामने वो खड़ा रहेगा या अगर कोई ऐसा पार्टिकल है जिसकी स्पीड मेरे कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम में जीरो है तो उसकी स्पीड प्राइम के अंदर क्या होगी माइनस क्यू होगी क्योंकि हमारा कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम उसके लिहाज से माइनस क्यू के लंबे है सो लेट्स टेक दिस सिंपल केस फर्स्ट अब ये थोड़ी सिमेट्री आ गई अब इसमें क्या हो रहा है कि इसके अंदर ये जो पार्टिकल है जो क्यू वन है इट्स मूविंग लाइक दिस नो गोइंग like this at speed u but this q is at rest और जो o prime है उसमें जो ये particle है ये u जा रहा है और जो ये particle है it's at rest ठीक है हम इस तरह से choose कर लिए कि दोनों की जो situation है वो relate होगी एक से दूसरे इसका फायदा मुझे ये हुआ है कि जो फोर्स है एफ एम दैट इज नाउ जीरो विच मीन्स दैट एफ इज नथिंग बट एफ सी and FC is nothing but FX prime system F is QE and in this one F prime is Q prime E prime. So here I put Q E naught. So here we put Q prime, we can take common. This is now E naught X.
क्यों क्यों प्राइम कह रहे हैं ये फ्रेम
में हां उसमें क्यों प्राइम कह रहे हैं इसमें क्यों कह रहे हैं
अच्छा ये भी नहीं कह रहे कि चार्ज से हम
अभी तक नहीं कहा बट नाउ वी हैव टू मेक सर्टेन असम्पशंस वी कैन ट्रांसफॉर्म इलेक्ट्रोस्टैटिक्स इनटू मैग्नेटोस्टैटिक्स इफ वी अज्यूम द फॉर्मूला एंड दैट इज दैट टू असम्पशंस नंबर 1 वी से दैट charge is the invariant. That whatever is charged is measured by this observer and this frame and this frame, they are both the same. So this is a quantity which is invariant from one inertial frame to another inertial frame. So which means that Q is equal to Q. The second is that we are going to assume that Gauss law. So let me tell you the implications. The implication is this, that if we have two frames, let's say O prime and O. Let's say here is some charge Q1 and here is some charge Q1. So the first thing, the first assumption means that is Q1 prime is the same as Q1. They both measure this particle to have the same total charge. And the second assumption means that if let's say I have some box around this thing. Then the total flux out of this box as computed by an observer in this frame and as computed by this observer in this frame is the same. This essentially relates to the conservation of charge again, but including the flux as well. Because Gauss law is this thing, right? The total flux is equal to Q enclosed over epsilon naught. So this thing holds in both frames. So since Q is same, it means total flux would also be the same. Okay, is say again, let's say some members, 10 members flux total utilized box. So is observer ko bhi yahi measure hoga ke 10 members nikla. Kyunki agar Q same hai dono mein, ye to universal constant hai. If Q is same, total flux is also going to be the same. Of course, the shape of the box is going to be different for both of them. And that's where the basic difference comes from. Because the lengths are going to be measured differently by both observers. But since the total flux is the same, we are now going to find out what should be the relation between the fields, electric fields, so that the charge is conserved and the total flux is the same. So, let me look at this surface first of all. अगर आप इस surface को देखें तो इसकी कुछ होगी, कुछ area होगा, कितना होगा, let's say this side is some, अगर ये x है, मैं इसको y ले लेता हूँ, इस side में तो z ले लेता हूँ, so this is lz and this dimension is lx. तो इसमें से जो flux होगा total इस charge का, वो होगा E x l x l z right, तो the prime की तरफ. और इसी साइड से ये observer कितना flux देखेगा, this would be E x l x l z. अब इसमें थोड़ा सा एक issue है कि मैंने बजाय total flux equate करने के सिर्फ इस एक phase के flux को equate, but I'll argue little bit later why they both mean the same thing. So again, ye flux or this phase of flux dono same observe kare, so we have this equation, right? But since ye x hai, ye y axis hai, to this length should be L1. ठीक है, ये फेस है ना, ये x एक्सिस के परपेंडिकुलर है, ये फेस है. अब ये दोनों डायमेंशन तो चेंज नहीं होती, सो lx lx प्राइम, lz lz प्राइम, व्हिच मींस दैट ex ex
y
z है ना, y z साइड चेंज नहीं होती, बिकॉज़ दिस फेस इज परपेंडिकुलर टू दिस. For this upper face, ये EY है, so इस box में होगा EY, और ये side में है Z, तो ये side LX है, so this is LZ, LX, और इस frame में EY prime, LZ prime, LX. अब ये LZ और LZ प्राइम तो बराबर है, लेकिन जो LX है दैट इज डिफरेंट फ्रॉम LX प्राइम. सो LX इज LZ, LZ प्राइम सेम है, कैंसिल हो जाएंगे, LX इज नथिंग बट LX प्राइम into 1 minus u square over c square. EY prime LX prime, so EY is either aake 1 over ho jayega or 1 over is nothing but kappa, so EY is kappa EY. Similarly jo EZ component hai, क्योंकि ये लेंथ श्रिंक हो जाएगी, ये लेंथ वैसे की वैसी रहेगी, सो इजी वुड बी कापा इजी. सो इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड के एक्स कंपोनेंट जो है इट हैज रिमेन अनचेंज, बट वाई एंड जी कंपोनेंट हैव इंक्रीज्ड. When we go from a stationary charge to a moving charge, remember these primes were the fields for the stationary charge in this frame, and these are the fields for the unstationary charge. So which means agar main total field likhu E jo hai to kya hoga, electric field E in this frame is EXX hat, EYY hat, EZ, Z है. अभी मैं इसको वो इक्वेशन में फुट करूँगा, बल्कि संक्षिप्त से सेम थी. इनसे आप, so ये Q और Q प्राइम बराबर हो गए, और E नॉट आ आएगा इस तरह से, बट वी कैन इंस्टेड ऑफ दिस थिंग पुटिंग लेट्स वर्क विद दिस थिंग. सो ex जो है इट्स ex प्राइम, ey जो है दिस इज kappa ey prime. ठीक है, we are actually able to this thing. And kappa z prime. So let me actually just put these equations here. So यही में आप ex bar की value put करें. ex bar की value क्या है? वो expression लें. ex bar का formula है 1/4 pi epsilon naught is common. तो x component होगा x prime minus x one prime x hat over r prime minus r1 prime q plus kappa y prime minus y1 prime y hat plus kappa ये स्ट्रक्चर में फील एग्जैक्टली वही है जो यहाँ पे है और लेकिन ये जो फील है ये स्ट्रक्चर में और ये स्ट्रक्चर में स्क्वीज हो जो एक्स एक्सिस के अलावा डेंसिटी है इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड की इट्स नो हायर देन द डेंसिटी इन दिस ब्लॉक जो कि आप ऐसे ये कुछ किए बगैर सिर्फ डेंसिटी का रिलेशन आप शुरू में भी निकाल सकते हैं कैसे पता कि इसके अंदर जो लेंथ है वो इसको श्रिंक कर रही है एंड टू कंजर्व द टोटल फ्लक्स जितना लाइंस इस लेंथ से गुजरी हैं वो सारी लेंथ लाइन इतनी लेंथ से गुजर रही सो द फील्ड लाइंस हैव टू शो एंड सिंस इट्स स्फेरिकल डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन हम डिस्क्रिप्शन देख के काम करते हैं सो नाउ वी सी दैट दिस इज द फील्ड ऑफ दिस मूविंग चार्ज एंड देयर दिस चार्ज एट रेस्ट सो दिस द फोर्स बिटवीन दीस टू चार्जेस इज डिफरेंट देन इफ बोथ चार्जेस वुड हैव बीन So in the next lecture, we are actually going to find the force. Or force will come up say simply you have a tool together, you have the force between the two. And this force is still electrostatic in nature, even though one charge is moving. But now it's different from the Coulomb law for two static charges. Dusri force is case where B is 0 hai FM because we took this thing to be stationary. Next lecture mein, we'll make both charges to move and then we will find the second force and we will see that it nicely fits the Lorentz force power magnetic field and we will also try and give you some more block in the boxes.